Well, it's Valentine's weekend, and of course, the husband is wondering whether chocolates and hot flowers would be the wisest thing here, or should they instead cut back and help contribute to RSPs? Joe Rich is the author of Parenting the Long Journey and a regular guest therapist, relationship therapist on City Line. Welcome, Joe.
Thank you, John. Thanks very much. First of all, it's not fair that Valentine's Day is just before the RSP season. That's not fair. Because, you know, I think the answer to the question is to be an expert on your own relationship, to know who your partner is. If the two of you are spending a lot of time saving up for the mortgage or saving up to buy something, and then you go out and blow a bundle, then you're really buying these gifts for somebody else. And so I think there's a link between sort of relationships, intimacy, and money. And there isn't an exact answer. I think you have to be an expert on your own relationship as you go along.
Now, you just did a poll in conjunction with TD Waterhouse.
Yes.
And Patricia Lovett-Reed. And what was the conclusion?
Well, I mean, it was a poll about retirement. There's an interest now in couples in retirement. Probably many years ago, one person in the family would go off and do the retirement planning. Now we find that the relationship winds up at the door. So, you know, the TD Waterhouse poll tells us that 50% of couples are probably not talking about their retirement. And that's not a good sign. When they ask me to come on board, my first response is, you know, couples don't talk about sex, money, and in-laws. Those are three general areas that we find are more difficult to talk about. Retirement is about money, although it really could be a discussion about life goals as well.
Now, was there anything surprising in that survey? It was something they hadn't done before, although you had a previous gig with TD.
Yes. The previous gig was about does your relationship reflect your finances, and your finances reflect your relationship. This poll was more about conflict. Are couples in conflict? Are they planning ahead, and are they in conflict? So one out of five couples winds up in conflict. I mean, this is what the poll tells us, has been in conflict talking about their retirement goals and where they're planning to go and how they're saving for that. And this is where the third party comes in. This is where somebody who can be helpful to the relationship could be inserted 10 years before retirement, 20 years before retirement, it's not one conversation, it's usually a number of conversations along the way. But the first conversation is often the most difficult and not something you should initiate on Valentine's Day.
Well, I quote another author, Diane McCurdy, is a financial planner, mm-hmm, wrote the book How Much Is Enough, and mm-hmm. she talks about four money personalities,
yes.
Builders, givers, savers, spenders. Mm-hmm. And I think she argues that two savers, no problem. Two spenders, maybe not so good for...
Well, the truth is that two savers can be a problem, but that's a separate problem. When we have the spender and the saver together, it generally goes in one of two directions. Either it becomes a form of entrenchment where the two of them are constantly in argument, so that the more I say you spend too much, the more I spend too little, and then we sort of get to a spot where we're entrenched or polarized. But for lots of couples, it's complementary. They actually complement each other. They help each other. So the spender is encouraged to save and not spend so much. And the saver is encouraged to squeeze out a few bucks and have some enjoyment from their funds. So it's not always one or the other, but it's never both. In other words, it's either going to go in one direction or the other. And one is conflict and the other one is a nice complementary arrangement.
But it does help to have a shared vision of retirement. I mean, there are previous guests, the Retirement Rocks couple.
Yes.
Talked about that. What was your analysis there? I mean, obviously, mind you, they were both on their second marriage.
Yeah, well, that's interesting you say that. People in second marriages have talked more about retirement because they're closer to retirement, in the same way that people in first marriages are generally quite young and they talk about having children. So, you know, there are certain topics that are endemic to those stages in one's life. My thoughts, I did listen to the interview, and one of my thoughts was he talks about opening a business or starting a business in his retirement. I think it was a renovation business.
Right.
So I have this vision of the two of them are retired and they come back from the cottage and, you know, it's fall. And he says, oh, honey, I'm just going out to, you know, Home Depot and the car dealership and I'll be back in a few minutes. And he comes back with a truck and all the tools for his new business. And she thinks they're going to Yorkdale for the afternoon. So, you know, we got to be careful. The change will take place. Retirement can be a fabulous time, but it's also a time where people need to reinvent themselves. It's, you know, I mean, I see it in our world as the transition from always looking for time, because time is a commodity. We're always trying to find the time, and then all of a sudden we reach a point where we have the time. And it sounds simple, but it's a very different existence, not just for the individual, but for the partnership.
Speaking of time, I think we're out of it for this segment. Thank you very much, dear Rich, the author of Parenting, The Long Journey. Next time we're going to talk about that book and children and how that mucks up the relationship, if it does indeed.
Thank you.